viewers, this is Ajay Dutt with today's biology class. In the last video, we have finished the nutrition part of life process, where we have focused on digestive system of human being. And after finishing the digestive system of human being, now we are going to deal with the last part of nutrition, that is dental caries. And after finishing dental caries, we'll also deal with the vestigial organs. So dental caries, also called as tooth decay. So about dental caries and tooth decay, we are going to understand in today's class. Tooth decay. Tooth is singular, whereas teeth is plural, right? So we are discussing about the dental caries. So before dealing with the dental caries, let us first understand the structure of human tooth. When you look at the picture, you find that the human tooth is seen, or it can be classified, or can be divided into three regions. One is known as the crown region, second one is the neck region, and third one is the root region. So crown is the visible part of your tooth. So root is the one which is fixed into your jaw in the form of sockets. So between the root and the crown, the region is called as the neck. The region is called as the neck. So this is about the region of our tooth. Then we shall discuss about the parts of tooth. So although there are plenty of parts of our tooth, but in today's class we are only discussing about the three parts. The first part is the enamel, the second one is the dentine, and third one is the pulpy cavity. So first let us understand what are these structures, then we'll deal with the dental caries. The hardest part of our body is known as the enamel. Okay, so it is the hardest part of our body. So in the tooth, this is the most hard part. This is the enamel, and this enamel is composed of calcium and phosphorus compounds. Therefore, it is very hard in nature. Then followed by enamel, the second region is called dentine, and this dentine is bony, not so hard as enamel, but slightly harder than the enamel. Then the next region is a soft region or pulpy region, and this region is called as the pulpy cavity. So both enamel and dentine are protecting this pulpy cavity, as we find many intensive network of nerves as well as the blood capillaries are found in this region of our tooth. So now students, we have understood about the different regions of the tooth and different parts of the tooth. Now we shall deal with the dental caries or tooth decay. So what is this dental caries or what is the tooth decay? So it is a situation created when we do not brush our teeth properly. So over consumption of sugar and several other reasons leads to the dental caries or tooth decay. So the main organism or the pathogen here in the situation of dental caries is Streptococcus mutans. So this is the organism, this is a bacteria. It is responsible for dental caries. So what is happening here when you are not brushing your teeth properly, or when you do not brush your teeth before going to bed, during such a situation? So when you have already had your dinner, so you have not brushed your teeth and you simply went off to sleep. So during such a situations, so the remains of food into your buccal cavity. So because of presence of those food particles, that is, they are the simple sugars, and maybe they are complex sugars also. So because of these sugars available freely in the mouth, so few bacteria like Streptococcus mutans, they attack or they are found in the oral cavity of our body, So what do they do? So when that sugars, they settle down on the enamel part of our tooth, what happens there? Those bacterias, they act upon that available sugar. So when they act upon that available sugar, so they immediately start demineralizing the enamel. They destroy the enamel by demineralizing the calcium and phosphorus content on the enamel. So then the enamel becomes weak. Along with this, they are also producing some acids like lactic acid maybe. So they are producing some acids, and those acids can be neutralized by our saliva. But that doesn't happen because of formation of a film or a coat on the teeth, and that will expose the dentine. When dentine is going to expose, there is formation of cavities or dental plaque. That is formation of cavities or dental plaque. That situation is the dental plaque. So this is all about the dental caries or the tooth decay. So the causative organism is Streptococcus mutans, which is an bacteria. This is a very little bit information about the dental caries. So the best method of avoiding dental caries is rinse your mouth with the mouthwash, or regularly you can go with the brushing of your teeth after your dinner or for your lunch, or rinse your mouth thoroughly with some mouth cleansing agents. So from by doing all these things, you can avoid from the dental caries or tooth decay. Because once you suffer with the dental caries or tooth decay, so there are several complications in mastication process, that is in chewing up of food, and also swelling and some sort of infection may occur into your mouth. To avoid all those activities, you can go with the following remedies, that is brushing your teeth regularly or rinsing your mouth with some cleansing agents. Thank you. Now, vestigial organs. So what do we mean by vestigial organs? So the organs which are no longer functional in our body, they're all called as vestigial organs. That means these organs were functional in our ancestors, whereas they are non-functional in our body. So such non-functional organs of our body are called as vestigial organs. Vestigial organs. There are several vestigial organs in our body, but we are only dealing with one of the most important vestigial organ, which is in our GI tract, that is in digestive system we are going to study. The tip of your vertebral column, you are having a tail like projection, or at the tip we are having the tip of the vertebral column is also a vestigial organ. So the pinna of the ear is also a vestigial organ. So they are useful in the various group of the animals who were our ancestors, but they are not so functional in our body. They are not so functional in our body. So let us not focus more on them, but we'll focus on the vestigial organ, that is vermiform appendix. We have vermiform appendix. So when you look at this picture, so at the junction of small intestine and large intestine, this region is called as cecum. This region is called as the cecum, that is at the junction of small intestine as well as large intestine. This region is called as a cecum, and in this region we are having a worm-like structure or vermiform structure, and that vermiform structure is called as appendix. That vermiform structure is called as appendix. So what role does this appendix have in our human digestive system, that is our GI tract? It has no specific role in digesting in our digestive systems, as we are all omnivores. Yes, we are all omnivores. It is having no such specific function in our body. So because we have shifted to both mode of nutrition, that is carnivore mode of nutrition as well as the herbivore mode of nutrition. So what is the actual function of this appendix? The actual function of appendix is in the digestion of cellulose, and the cellulose component is mostly available in the herbivore mode of nutrition. It is available in herbivore mode of nutrition. Although even we do have some leafy vegetables, and it also has cellulose, but the cellulose component is far less compared to the rest nutrient sources. Therefore, the vestigial organ, therefore the appendix in our body has no actual function. Therefore, it is regarded as the vestigial organ of our body. It is regarded as the vestigial organ of our body. But it is functional in case of other mammals, which are specifically herbivores. But it is not functional in our body. In our ancestors, it was functional. But today in our body, it is not functional. It is not functional. Therefore, it is regarded as the vermiform appendix. So, this vermiform appendix sometimes gets infected due to various infections, or sometimes due to mechanical injuries, they inflammate or they swell up, and that situation is known as the appendicitis. That situation is known as appendicitis, where we surgically remove this appendix. So this was a very brief information about the vestigial organ, that is vermiform appendix, which is present in the junction of the small intestine and the large intestine. This is all about the vermiform appendix. Thank you. Hello viewers, welcome to our channel Appa Public School Kalburgi. In today's biology class, we are going to deal with the next part in the life process chapter, that is respiration. Before dealing with the chapter, let us understand or let us know about the definition of respiration. Respiration is defined as the process of breakdown of the organic molecules into simpler form. Complex organic molecules are broken down to simpler forms to release energy. Or simply, respiration is defined as the process of breakdown of glucose to release energy in the form of ATPs. ATP stands for adenosine triphosphate, which is the energy currency of our cell. So people always misunderstand that respiration and breathing are same. No, respiration and breathing are entirely different processes. So breathing is the process of intake of air, that is fresh air, then letting out the foul air out of our body, or the process of intake of air and letting out of air from our body is known as breathing, and breathing is never the same as respiration, right? Breathing is a physical process, whereas respiration is a biochemical process. So we will understand the differences between the breathing and respiration after a bit of time. So before that, we will deal with the definition of digestion once, because after the process of digestion, whatever nutrients are available, those nutrients are further broken down to release energy. Therefore, we need to understand what actually means respiration. Before understanding what actually means respiration, we need to understand the process of digestion. That is definition of digestion. Digestion is the process of breakdown of complex food materials, that is, which are in insoluble forms. The process of breakdown of complex food materials into simpler forms, that is easily soluble forms. So they are known as, that is known as the digestion process. So we consume food, we break down that food material to release nutrients, and when nutrients are released, those nutrients are further, by the process called as respiration, they are broken down to release energy. So simply, food to nutrients, digestion process, then nutrients to energy, respiration process. They are two interconnected processes, interconnected processes. We digest to extract nutrients out of food, and we respire to convert that nutrients into energy, which is taking place in our cell. So here are the list of few. Here are the list of few nutrients. Okay, like carbohydrates, or simply we call them as carbs. So the end product of carbohydrate digestion is simple sugars like fructose, sucrose, glucose. Okay, so these are all the glucose. We will deal with the glucose only. Let us not explain you more and confuse. So we will only deal with the glucose, which is a simple product. Glucose. Okay, so end product of carbohydrate digestion is glucose. Then end product of protein digestion will be amino acids. Then end product of fat digestion or lipid digestion will be fatty acids and glycerol. So when we digest carbohydrate, we get glucose. When we digest proteins, we get amino acids. And when we digest the fat, we get fatty acids and glycerol. So the process of extracting the glucose from the carbs, that is carbohydrates, is the digestion process. Like same as protein, amino acids, fat, fatty acids and glycerol, this is a digestion process. Then from this glucose, we are generating energy. This is respiration process. This is respiration process. Now we have understood what do you mean by respiration, what do you mean by digestion, and what do you mean by breathing. Breathing is a process of intake of air and letting out of air. Never ever say the process of intake of oxygen and letting out of carbon dioxide, because when we are inhaling air, we are not only taking the oxygen, but we are taking air. That is, air is always a mixture of gas. So it can be defined, or the respiration must be defined as the process of inhaling air, not the process of inhaling oxygen. Then when we are exhaling the air, or when we are exhaling, so we are not only releasing the carbon dioxide which is generated into our body, along with the other gases which are of no use to us, we are sending the carbon dioxide. So simply breathing can be defined as the process of inhaling air and exhaling air. That's it. That is the breathing. Then comes respiration, process of breakdown of glucose to release energy. Glucose is an organic molecule. It is converted into the simpler forms to release energy, that is in the form of ATP. ATP stands for adenosine triphosphate. ATP stands for adenosine triphosphate. Then comes the digestion process. Process of breakdown of complex food materials into simpler forms, where insoluble forms of food are converted into simpler forms, which are utilized by our body for energy production. Right. So now dealing with the differences. So before dealing with the differences between respiration and breathing, let me tell you a thing. Okay. So simply we can understand the digestion process. Okay. So whenever you eat roti, so roti is mainly made up of wheat or sorghum. So wheat and sorghum also let us take example of the sorghum. So they are rich in carbohydrates. So when you eat roti, you get carbohydrates. And when you digest these carbohydrates, so you get glucose. And this breakdown of, that is when we are consuming roti, we are getting the carbohydrates, and this breakdown of carbohydrates releases the glucose. So this is digestion process. That is, roti to carbohydrates, carbohydrates to glucose is digestion process. Then after that we get the glucose to ATP, that is respiration process. Glucose to ATP, that is respiration process. Now with this simple example, Let us now deal with the differences between respiration and breathing. Now let us deal with the differences between respiration and breathing. So respiration, the first and foremost difference is respiration, the second one is breathing. Respiration is the process of breakdown of glucose to release energy. Then the second, that is the first difference in breathing, is it is process of intake of air and letting out air. This is the first difference. That is glucose, the breakdown of glucose to release energy is respiration, process of intake of air and letting out air is breathing. This is the first difference. Then the second difference is it is a biochemical process. It is a biochemical process. So what is biochemical process? Biochemical processes involves the enzymes. Okay. So these are the reactions which are involving certain enzymes, and enzymes are called as biocatalyst, which will fasten the rate of reaction. They are called as the catalyst. And certain enzymes in our body, they are acting as a biocatalyst. That means which are fastening the rate of reaction. That is digestive enzymes we are having. That means those enzymes are enhancing the rate, or they are increasing the rate of digestion process. So they are all called as biocatalysts. So it is a biochemical process. That means it is involving enzymes, which will be the third difference. We will write about it later on. Now dealing with the second difference, it is a physical process. Breathing is a physical process. So physical process means it does not involve the enzymes in its reaction. So third difference, many enzymes are involved in this reaction, in here, or many enzymes are involved in the breathing part. No enzymes are involved. This is the third difference. Fourth difference is respiration is carried out in all cells of our body. But breathing is confined or restricted to only few organs of our body. That is, in case of human beings, it is lungs. In case of amphibians, it is through gills, lungs and skin. In aquatic creatures, it is mostly through gill slits, so on. Then the fifth difference, it is intercellular process, which means it takes place within the cell, and here it is extracellular process. Extracellular process. This is the fifth difference. Then last, then we align few more differences. Energy is generated no energy is generated. So energy is generated in respiration process, no energy is generated in the breathing process. So these are the few differences between the respiration and breathing, starting with it is the breakdown of glucose to release energy, it is the process of intake of air and letting out of air, it is a biochemical process, it is a physical process. Respiration, many enzymes are involved. Breathing, no enzymes are involved. Respiration, it is intercellular process, that is, it takes place inside cells. So breathing, it takes place, it is an extracellular process, that is, it takes place outside the cell. And respiration is carried out in almost all cells of our body, whereas breathing is restricted or confined only to few organs of our body. Then last difference is energy is generated in respiration, so no energy is generated in breathing. So this is the difference. These are the few differences between respiration and breathing, which is the most important concept to be known. Now we shall deal with different modes of respiration. Now we have already understood what do we mean by respiration. Now what do we mean by breathing. Now we shall understand about types of respiration. Types of respiration. So there are mainly two types of respiration. One is aerobic respiration and the other one is anaerobic respiration. Aerobic respiration, aerobic mode of respiration. Anaerobic respiration, anaerobic mode of respiration. And the animals, the organisms which respire in the presence of oxygen, they are called as aerobes or aerobic organisms. We are all aerobes. Then the organisms which respire in limited supply of oxygen or in complete absence of oxygen, they are all called as anaerobes. And their mode of respiration is anaerobic. Aerobic mode of respiration, anaerobic mode of respiration. So fermentation, which is the most important process in many distilleries and also in the bakery and beverage industries. So there, fermentation is the continuous process which is going to take place, and this fermentation is a type of anaerobic respiration. So aerobic respiration, in presence or excess of oxygen. Anaerobic respiration, respiration in limited supply. Limited supply refers to inadequate supply of oxygen, or in a restricted manner oxygen will be there. So, or total absence of oxygen. So, aerobic respiration, respiration in presence of oxygen or excess of oxygen. So, anaerobic respiration, respiration in limited supply of oxygen or absence of oxygen. Is that clear? Then, differences between aerobic and anaerobic respiration. Differences between aerobic and anaerobic respiration. Now we shall deal. Now we shall deal with the differences between aerobic and anaerobic respiration. First with the aerobic respiration followed by anaerobic respiration.
So let me wipe it off. So maximum space out of the board.
So, aerobic respiration and anaerobic respiration. The first and foremost difference between aerobic and anaerobic mode of respiration is it takes place in presence of oxygen. So, anaerobic respiration takes place in absence or limited supply of oxygen. Second difference, aerobic respiration takes place in two places of our cell. That is, it takes place in both in cytoplasm and mitochondria. So whereas anaerobic respiration takes place only in cytoplasm. Then, in aerobic respiration, complete breakdown of glucose takes place. Complete breakdown of glucose takes place. Then, in anaerobic respiration, partial breakdown or incomplete breakdown of glucose takes place. The third difference. Then fourth difference is, due to complete breakdown of glucose, maximum ATPs are generated. maximum ATPs are generated. So here negligible amount of ATPs are generated, or minimum maximum ATPs are generated, minimum ATPs are generated here. Then end products 1, 2, 3, 4 we have finished. The last difference between aerobic and anaerobic respiration, that is end products of aerobic respiration. End products are CO2, H2O and ATP. CO2, H2O and CO2, H2O and ATP are the end products of aerobic respiration. Then coming to anaerobic respiration. So under anaerobic respiration, the end products are lactate or lactic acid, then ethanol, etc. are generated as a end product of anaerobic respiration. So hope you understood the differences between aerobic and anaerobic respiration. So these are the 5 differences between aerobic and anaerobic respiration. Thank you. Yes. Next will the types of breakdown of glucose. So as you are already knowing about aerobic and anaerobic respiration, so how aerobically we are breaking down glucose and how anaerobically we are breaking down glucose, we are going to understand now. So under aerobic breakdown of glucose or aerobic respiration, the glucose, which is a 6-carbon compound, is broken down to pyruvate, which is 3-carbon compound. So this takes place in our cells, especially in the cytoplasm. The process of breakdown of glucose to pyruvate is called as glycolysis, so which you don't study in the 10th standard, you are studying that in grade 11 or 12, probably grade 11. And under bioenergetics chapter, we are going to study about the glycolysis, that is breakdown of glucose there. So here in aerobic respiration, glucose, which is a 6-carbon compound, C6, is broken down to pyruvate, which is 3-carbon compound in the cytoplasm. Then when oxygen acts upon with the pyruvate, which is 3-carbon compound, there is creation of carbon dioxide, water and adenosine triphosphate, are called as energy. Now when we look at this chemical reaction, that is with the chemical formula, C6H12O6, which is a 6-carbon compound, which is glucose, is broken down to the pyruvate C3H4O3 and in the cytoplasm. Then next, the pyruvate acts with the oxygen in the mitochondria. So in the differences, we have already mentioned that aerobic respiration takes place both in cytoplasm and mitochondria. Therefore, glucose to pyruvate in cytoplasm, and pyruvate upon action of oxygen, it takes place in mitochondria. We get carbon dioxide, CO2, H2O, that is water, and ATP with the chemical formula C10H16N5O13P3. There are 38 molecules of ATP generated. There are 38 molecules of ATP generated here. So this is the first method of breakdown of glucose in the presence of oxygen or in excess of oxygen. Now, moving on to the next one, that is anaerobic respiration in a limited supply of oxygen. So, this type of respiration takes place in our cells, that is our all normal cells. So, anaerobic respiration also takes place in our cells, but which type of cells? Only in the muscle cells. Muscle cells of our body. So, when you continuously exercise, so due to lots of physical activities, there is continuous need of energy. Therefore, to supply the continuous energy, to supply the continuously needed energy, our cells also respire in an anaerobic mode. That is, whatever little amount of oxygen is available, so utilizing that little amount of oxygen, so they are going to respire, and when they are utilizing little amount of oxygen, they are also going to generate little amount of energy, but not complete amount or maximum amount of energy. So in anaerobic respiration in our muscle cells, what happens? The glucose is once again converted to pyruvate in the cytoplasm, and later on, due to limited supply of oxygen in the cell, what is happening here? Instead of CO2, water and energy, an intermediate compound lactic acid or lactate is generated. So what is happening here? Intermediate, instead of CO2 and H2O, we are getting an intermediate product, that is lactic acid or lactate, and along with this lactic acid or lactate, there is generation of little amount of adenosine triphosphate, where only two molecules are generated here. So glucose is broken down to pyruvate, pyruvate to lactic acid, and little amount of energy is generated. So according to the chemical reactions, if we go, so C6H12O6, which is 6 carbon compound, is converted into 3 carbon compound, C3H4O3, which is pyruvate. So this pyruvate acts upon the limited available oxygen, therefore creating an intermediate product called as lactic acid or lactate with the chemical formula C3H6O3. Along with this, only two molecules of ATPs are generated, that is C10H16, N5O13P3. Only two are produced. So this is about the aerobic respiration taking place in normal cells and anaerobic respiration taking place in our muscle cells. Then, so because of generation of lactic acid in our cells, so what is happening? We feel tired or fatigued immediately after the lots of physical activities or lots of exercises. That's all. So now, anaerobic respiration, that is in complete absence of oxygen. So previously we have studied, or we are knowing about the limited supply of oxygen and the complete supply of oxygen. Now we are dealing with the complete absence of oxygen, that is taking place in the yeast cell. So you are all aware of the significance of yeast in bakery and beverage industries. It is especially in alcoholic fermentation, all those things, in distilleries. So yeast is also used for the production of the alcohol, because alcohol is also intermediate product which is generated as a result of partial breakdown of glucose. So once again, in anaerobic respiration, that is in complete absence of oxygen, glucose, which is a 6 carbon compound, is converted into pyruvate, which is a 3 carbon compound. And in absence of oxygen, there is generation of ethanol with the chemical formula C2H5OH, also CH3CH2OH. Then carbon dioxide is also generated. Along with carbon dioxide, little amount of energy is generated in the form of ATP, which is the energy currency of the cell, also called as adenosine triphosphate. So chemically, C6H12O6, that is glucose, is converted into pyruvate with the chemical formula C3H4O3. Then in absence of oxygen, in complete absence of oxygen, so what is happening? An intermediate product, that is called as ethanol or ethyl alcohol, with the chemical formula C2H5OH or CH3CH2OH, is generated, and along with the ethanol, carbon dioxide is generated, and along with the ethanol and carbon dioxide, ATP molecules, that is negligible amount of ATP molecules are produced with the chemical formula C10H16N5O13P3. So this is how the third method of breakdown of glucose takes place. In first method, we are knowing about the breakdown of glucose in presence of oxygen, that is aerobic respiration. In second method, that is anaerobic respiration, we have studied about the breakdown of glucose in a limited supply of oxygen with the formation of byproduct like lactate. And in the third one, that is we are going to produce ethanol by partial breakdown of glucose. So aerobic respiration, complete breakdown of glucose yielding maximum amount of ATP. So anaerobic respiration is partial breakdown or incomplete breakdown of glucose yielding minimum or negligible amount of energy. Same here also, lactic acid is generated in limited supply of oxygen. So in the last one, that is in the complete absence of oxygen, ethanol, carbon dioxide and ATPs are generated. So these are the three different methods of breakdown of glucose in the presence of oxygen, in a limited supply of oxygen, and in complete absence of oxygen. Thank you.